Well, good morning. I'm Ted Haggard from St. James Church in Colorado Springs, Colorado. And as you can tell, I'm in the basement. And the reason I'm in the basement is because we have grandchildren here visiting, enjoying, having a wonderful, wonderful time with Papa Ted, that's me, and Nana, that's Gail. Gail and I have been married 45 years, and these are the children of Marcus, who is our oldest son, who is in Iceland on vacation. Okay, so just don't judge it. He's an adventurer, and so he does things like going to Iceland on vacation, and he went with a whole bunch of buddies, and they're all lined up in these all-terrain vehicles, and they're going around the whole country. And so pray for his safety and his sanity. Okay. Today we're talking about Acts, the 24th chapter, which is very interesting because this is the Apostle Paul in court being accused with lies. Now, I am not making a political statement. I'm just saying there's nothing new under the sun. And when people want to use the court system to limit or remove or whatever an enemy, then they make up lies and they charge them. And that happened to the Apostle Paul. We will start with this address to the governor accusing Paul. And I'll point it out to you. So we are in the last portion of verse 2 of chapter 24 of Acts. You have provided a long, speaking to the governor, you have provided a long period of peace for us Jews, and with foresight have enacted reforms for us. For all of this, Your Excellency, we are very grateful to you. But I don't want to bore you, so please give me your attention for only a moment. We have found this man to be a troublemaker. That is not true. Who is constantly stirring up riots. That's not true. Among the Jews all over the world, he is a ringleader of the cult known as the Nazarenes. Partially true. Furthermore, he was trying to desecrate the temple when we arrested him. That's not true. You can find out the truth of our accusations by examining him yourself. See, the problem is they didn't have the internet then. And so since they didn't have the internet, they couldn't do research and find the truth because everything on the internet is true. We know. Okay. That was a joke, by the way, for those of you that have no sense of humor. All right. Verse 9. Then the other Jews chimed in, declaring that everything Tertullius said was true. You see that? It's so interesting. When people are aligned against somebody or against an idea, they'll lie and then they'll say, oh yeah, he's telling the truth. All right. The governor then motioned for Paul to speak. Paul said, I know, sir, that you have been a judge of Jewish affairs for many years, so I gladly present my defense before you. You can quickly discover that I arrived in Jerusalem no more than 12 days ago to worship at the temple. My accusers never found me arguing with anyone in the temple, nor stirring up a riot in any synagogue or on the streets of the city. These men cannot prove the things they accuse me of doing, although they have all those witnesses saying, oh yeah, it's true. But I admit that I follow the way, which they call a cult. I worship the God of our ancestors, and I firmly believe the Jewish law and everything written in the prophets. I have the same hope in God that these men have, that he will raise both the righteous and the unrighteous. Because of this, I will try to maintain a clear conscience before God and all the people. This guy is awesome. After several years away, I returned to Jerusalem with money to aid my people and to offer sacrifices to God. Okay, you follow that? The reason he came to Jerusalem was because the churches in Jerusalem were suffering and they needed money. And so he collected money from his missionary journeys and was bringing it to the churches. And he wanted to worship at the temple. My accuser saw me in the temple as I was contemplating a purification ceremony. There was no crowd around me and no rioting. But some Jews from the province of Asia were there, and they ought to be here to bring charges if they have something against me. Ask these men here what crime the Jewish High Council found me guilty of. Except for the one time I shouted out, I am on trial before you today because I believe in the resurrection of the dead. That's a one time. At that point, Felix, who was quite familiar with the way, adjourned the hearing and said, wait until Lysias, the garrison commander, arrives. Then I will decide the case. He ordered an officer to keep Paul in custody, but to give him some freedom and allow his friends to visit him and take care of his needs. Now follow this, everybody. A few days later, Felix came back with his wife, Drusilla, who was Jewish. Sending for Paul, they listened as he told them about faith in Christ Jesus. As he reasoned with them about righteousness and self-control and the coming day of judgment, Felix became frightened. Go away for now, he replied. When it is more convenient, I'll call for you again. He also hoped that Paul would bribe him. So he sent him quite often to talk to him. He wanted money from him. Okay, now everybody, pay close attention. After 2 years went by in this way, Paul sat there in prison for 2 years with false charges and with the powers that be kind of hoping they're going to get a benefit from him. All right, after 2 years went by in this way, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus, and because Felix wanted to gain favor with the Jewish people, he left Paul in prison. I know you're thinking right now about how we see that very same thing today, and we do. And we've got to clean that up. I don't know why Americans vote for these people. Okay. All right. That's it. That's Acts, the 24th chapter. And it's very good and telling about human nature. Okay. The Lord Jesus bless you. Bye-bye.